Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to worship at First Baptist Church. We're so delighted that you've joined us on this rainy morning. Today we celebrate Father's Day. We remember the love and care that our earthly fathers have given us that reflects that love we receive from God the Father. If you will look in your pew, we've got these awesome yellow cards. We're going to keep talking about them for a few more weeks. Visitors, on the back, there's a get to know you section. Would love for you to fill that out and place in the offering plate. And then if you have prayer concerns or need to share anything with the church office, the inside of it is the way to go. Let's turn our hearts to God, remembering the great Father who sent his Son to this earth so that we might know love better. Let's worship.
pray with me. Our Father, we do praise your name today. As we celebrate Father's Day for all the fathers in our lives, our fathers of the past as well as our fathers today, that we remember the good times, those special times we spent together, or that we now spend together. May we understand that you, Lord, are our Heavenly Father, and we celebrate you every day and especially today. Through Jesus, you have shown us how to live our lives so that we will honor you in all that we say and do, and that we understand better how to love each other through his example. We open our hearts and minds today to feel your presence as we worship you in song and in word. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Glad to see you today. It's a special day, isn't it? Father's Day. So have y'all done something really special? Ah, that's cool. And some of you are going to have special things you'll do later. That's neat. You know, I got to thinking about it, and I started thinking about how many things that I do every week that I learned from my dad in some way or another. I think about, it goes to my memories, my dad's been gone a long time, but I think about how many things he taught me that I don't even realize until I do it, and then I think, well, you know, dad's the one that showed me how to do that. You know, when it snowed sometime this year, and I got out and walked in the snow, I started thinking about, my dad taught me how to walk in the snow and not fall down. He used to say you had to do your legs a certain way in order to kind of walk stiff-legged in order to keep from falling. If you did it a different way, he said you might fall. There are things that I've learned to do, skills that I learned specifically from my dad. And every time I do them, I think, you know, dad taught me how to do this. You know, dad taught me how to do certain things with a car and certain other things around. He also taught me some values, and that when I make a decision, I'll think, well, Dad taught me that that's the right kind of decision to make. And Dad taught me about God. He taught me about how important God is in my life. He and Mom both did. And all of the things that we did around our house surrounded that kind of faith experience. And while my faith belongs to me, I learned it first through my parents. You know, the scripture teaches that you should train up a child in the way they should go. Now, y'all always hear the part about obey your father and mother, right? Don't y'all always hear that? They tell you that. We hear that a lot in Sunday school and other places. But it also says to parents, you need to do a good job too. You need to train up. You need to teach these things to your children. And so I can tell you that at my age, I still look back and know that I had parents that taught me the way that they should, and there's not a single day that ever goes by that I don't use something that they taught me. So let me tell you a secret. If I had it to do over, you know what I'd do? I'd listen a little better, because I'm sure I missed something along the way that I had to learn a different way. You know what else? I would thank them more often and thank them for teaching me these things. You know what else I'd do? I would make sure that I lived up to it to the best that I could. So now that's my clue. And I'll tell you, because you've still got time to do exactly that. You can listen better, you can thank them, and you can live it the way that they teach you. And realize that they are helping to lay the groundwork for the rest of your lives. I think that's pretty neat, don't you? So you give gifts and you say Happy Father's Day and you thank your parents for the good things they do. But the best gift you'll ever give them is when you go and say, I learned this or that from you. That's the best gift of all. Let's have a prayer and ask God to help us to listen and to learn and to do. Okay? Dear God, thank you for parents that love us, and we think particularly about our daddies today. Thank you for helping us when we listen, when we learn, and when we do what they've taught us. They're listening to you and training us up the way we ought to go. And we listen to you in obeying our parents. Help all of this to come together and to help make good life for each of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. I know we have, you know, fathers come in a lot of different ways. They come to us as our biological fathers, for sure. But there are also people in our lives that give us fatherly advice and that actually fill a space in our lives that's particularly special. Some of us have told our fathers goodbye as they've gone to heaven, some of you pretty recently. Others, you have the opportunity to talk with them now. Some are fading in their memory and other things, and you're kind of walking with them through that. For some of you, this is your first time to be a father. This is your first Father's Day, and you're celebrating that. So there's so many ways that God gives us that opportunity to give influence. But I want us to ask our fathers and grandfathers all to stand, if you will, and great-grandfathers. Would you stand for just a moment? It's always nice to recognize this crew and to offer a blessing to you from this congregation, from those who love you, from a world that is benefited by what you have offered, and also for the gift that God has given in allowing you that influence in others' lives. Thank you very much. Would you bow with me as together we all pray? Lord, we think about a lot of things in our lives, and we think about those who have influenced us, some as the fathers that helped bring us into this world, and then others that you have added to the influence of our lives that, with that fatherly advice, with that special gift, have offered to us something that we can carry every day. You've given us connections that have allowed us to learn more about life faster than we ever would just on our own. And you've given us insight and depth and wisdom that we never would have had without their being a part of our lives. So some of us in our memories, some of us are able to literally embrace them now. For others, we realize this is their beginning step. These are their beginning steps in being fathers. And I pray that you will guide their steps and give to them the wisdom and understanding they need. Define all that is done by love. And in love, we know you are present. And in that presence, we know that we have wisdom beyond ourselves. And so as you've given children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren the gift of that influence, I pray that it will be appreciated and heard and followed and passed along when they have the opportunity to parent as well. Please bless those who are in hospitals today and those who are grieving, those who are lonely for some in some way or another, and those who are dealing with life issues. Bless those that are deployed. Some are just looking for their dads to come home, and we pray for safety as they do. And for others in life, you know what the circumstances are. Please bless them as well. May this be a moment of celebration and blessing, but will your Spirit touch in a remarkable way the lives of these who parent. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Thank you. I was reminded this morning that on the days before Father's Day when I was a child, it was not uncommon for me to go to my father and ask him for the money to buy his gift. Every now and then I would receive more than I expected, and he would say, "Get me something nice." Please pray with me as we prepare to give a gift to our Father, who has already given us the means to provide that gift. Let's pray. Our Father, we come to you on this Father's Day, prepared to return to you a gift you have already given us. Let us do that joyfully, and we ask that you multiply this gift in a way that serves you, glorifies you, and brings you all the honor you deserve. For it's in your precious name we pray. Amen.
I think children should be seen and heard, like these children are playing in our backyard here. That's why Roxanne and I host the monthly children's Bible study for First Baptist Church. You know, the Bible's for adults, but it's also for children. And the children have a lot to learn. And seeing the Bible through the eyes of children makes me feel closer to God, too. At First Baptist, we're serious about teaching kids the Bible.
Good morning and welcome to worship with our First Baptist Church family here in a rainy, beautiful uptown Columbus, Georgia. It's a day when we are receiving God's blessing of the rain, for sure, but it's also a day when we're receiving God's blessings in a lot of ways. My head is filled with memories of my dad and my grandfather and the gifts that they gave me that continue to be given every day in my life. And I know some of you have those same memories, and some of you are with your parents right now, and you're having an opportunity to celebrate their lives with them. It's my prayer that you will always appreciate and always receive benefit from the gifts that they've given in teaching an example of life. Thank you for joining us. I pray that this will be a meaningful service for you. And if you have prayer requests that we may join you in, please let us know about them. We're always happy to do that. I've also asked that if you have a special hymn or a special part of scripture or something you'd like for us to use in the worship service, let us know. And we'll factor it in the months ahead as we're planning worship. Thank you for being a part of today. May God bless you in every possible way. And happy Father's Day to those of you who are fathers. Thank you for joining us.
As we try to understand each move he makes, but when the path grows dim and our questions have no answers, turn to him. Bow the knee, trust the heart of your Father when the answer goes beyond what you can see. Bow the knee, lift your eyes toward heaven and believe the one who holds eternity. When you don't understand,
That is a beautiful and reverent anthem. And I couldn't help but think, when they sang about the storms and the lightning and the thunder hit outside, timing is everything. You know that. But also, I thought about it. When I was growing up, we'd go to the farm, to my grandparents' house, and I've told you about that in the past, but one of the things that would happen is we'd have these summer storms that would come up with the thunder and the lightning and all of that. And Grandmother and Big Daddy would always say, well, let's just go lie down. So everybody would go lie down, turn off all the lights, and lie down. Later on, when I was more cynical, I decided that was just to get us to take a nap and be quiet. But as a child, I remember that there was this sense of reverence that took place. Everything darkens down, everything quiets, and let God have His say in the storm that's around us. And then after the storm went away and the sun came out, then we got up and we went back to life as normal. So bow the knee kind of relates to that, or helps me relate to that again. So I sat there remembering all of that. You know, it's all about memories. It's all about the things that we learn. And everything that we learn, even the smallest thing, the little small symbols like that, matter. They matter in some way or another within our lives. They matter in the crafting of what our lives will be like. Think how different you'd be if you did not have the influences of parents that you've had, that fatherly advice, that fatherly wisdom that you have had in your life. And some of you, it's biological, some of you adoptive, some of you from someone who just advised you that way. And then in some cases, I've had a whole bunch of dads in my life, and some in particular that have taught me things that I'll never forget. But it's the most interesting thing to think about. And my favorite passage when I think about parenting in Scripture is one that we usually give a different focus to. It's in Luke 2, beginning with the 40th verse. And that's our text today. And it deals with Jesus at 12 years of age. And it always fascinates me when I read it, because we usually talk about this in terms of Jesus kind of coming into His own and understanding, I must be about my Father's business, and the story of His parents being there and going to the temple and then going back home and finding that He was missing. That story is kind of a subordinate to the big message we always give, which is, and God, He was about His Father's business. And we go into that. The reality is, there is a treasure in here that is easy to miss. Do you realize that we actually get to see Jesus' earthly parents' parenting skills in this particular passage? We get to see the influence of godly parents in Jesus' life. And it becomes an example for us in our lives as parents. It's beautiful. Well, look at it with me for a second. Luke 2, beginning with the 40th verse. And the child, that's Jesus, grew and became strong. He was filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. That's where we jade it to start with. We say, of course the grace of God was on him. He was the Son of God. Yes, that's true. But that's not the message. Anytime a child is born, that child is intended to grow and to develop. Anytime a child is born, the grace of God is on that child, is available to that child. It's how we teach them to hear God and see God. It is how they open their hearts to salvation and hope. The grace is there for everybody. It's not unique to Jesus in this particular passage. This could be written about any one of us. And that's why this directs us toward what our lives are about. Verse 41, every year his parents went to Jerusalem for the feast of the Passover. When he was 12 years old, they went up to the feast according to the custom. After the feast was over, while his parents were returning home, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem, but they were unaware of it. Thinking he was in their company, they traveled on for a day. Then they began looking for him among their relatives and friends. And when they didn't find him, they went back to Jerusalem to look for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple courts, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. Everyone who heard him was amazed at his understanding and his answers. And when his parents saw him, they were astonished. His mother said to him, "Son, why have you treated us like this? Your father and I have been anxiously searching for you." "Why were you searching for me?" he asked. "Didn't you know I had to be in my father's house?" Or I think King James says, "be about my father's business." But they did not understand what he was saying to them. Then he went down to Nazareth with them and was obedient to them. I think King James says, "was subject to them." But his mother treasured all these things in her heart, and Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and men. You see, the progressive growth and development of Jesus as a person continues. And even in this passage at the end, it reminds us that with everything that had happened, all of that is going to factor into this last little bit that says, "and he continued to grow in wisdom." And part of the wisdom came right out of this. "And in stature." Well, he was 12 years old. He was having a growth spurt. "And in favor with God and men." Bring it into that human context where we begin to understand in a deeper way what it feels like to be with Jesus and to be with his family. You know, with communication the way it is, it's fascinating to me how we can be anywhere we want to be in a moment. We can experience most anything in a moment. We can have a TV anchor here in Columbus, Georgia, sitting behind his little desk with the pictures of Columbus behind him or her, and as they look at it, they'll say, "Let me take you to so-and-so," and they'll take us instantly to someone in New York. And that person in New York may have people on a panel who might simultaneously be in Singapore and London and Los Angeles and Washington, all commenting on whatever event is there. Literally, in one moment, an anchor here to our television set here reaches all over the world and brings us into an experience all over the world. So if there's a summit in Singapore, we're there. If there's something happening in London, we're there. If there's a volcano erupting in Hawaii or in South America, we can be there and we can all but feel the heat of that lava as it flows. And we can sense the tragedy of it as someone loses someone in it, and we see the tears and we feel for them. It is amazing what it means to be brought into a moment like that. And you never really know where they are, but they make a difference in your life. One of the funniest things that happened to me was several years ago, I was at a Mercer trustee meeting, and before I left the hotel that morning to go to the meeting, I turned on television, and as I was getting dressed, and one of the morning news shows was on, and they were interviewing or having commentary from Nancy Grace. Well, Nancy is on the trustees at Mercer, too, and supposed to be at that meeting that day. So I looked at it, it was out of New York, and there she was. And so I thought, well, she's not going to make it to the meeting today. So I went on to the meeting. When I walked in, I looked up, and she walked in. I said, "Nancy, how did you get here so fast?" And she said, "What do you mean?" I said, "I just saw you on Good Morning America or something, and you were in New York." She said, "No, I wasn't. I was in my parents' backyard. They did a satellite uplink, and we're able to do that." You never know how quickly they can move people, and they can seem to be in one place and be in another. Well, I thought about, in my growing up years, how much I enjoyed, and still do actually, being carried to those places and being able to see and experience those things. And I thought about how, when I was growing up, Walter Cronkite was still around, and he was still doing those "You Are There's." How many of y'all remember the "You Are"? Yeah, y'all. A lot of y'all remember "You Are There." And it was interesting because he would take an historic event, and he would take you to that event, and acting as a reporter would let you see Alexander Hamilton and Aaron Burr as they were in a duel with each other. Or he would take you to Washington crossing the Delaware. And as Washington's there, he's sticking a microphone in his face saying, "What does it feel like to be here?" And he would cover it like a news reporter actually on the scene, and he would take you to that place. I learned so much about history from those particular moments because it was different from reading it in a static way from a page where you say this happened and this happened and this happened to hearing a conversation and seeing that you were there, even though it was a reenactment. I thought about what would happen if we took this story today and if we allowed that same kind of thing to take place. I've played with this through the years, and this is kind of interesting to me. So if we were doing that, this is kind of the way it would go. Walter Cronkite, or whoever the person happened to be, might say something like, "We go now to the Jewish temple in Jerusalem in Judea. The year is AD 12 or so, and you are there." Our scene opens with a gathering of Jewish scholars, priests, holy men, and onlookers. They appear to be engaged in deep scholarly conversation. Maybe it's a visiting scholar. Maybe it's with a rabbi who has a new interpretation of the scriptures. Maybe it's with an elderly scholar, a mentor to the group that they just enjoy listening to, or someone whom they respect so deeply. Whatever it is, they're paying close attention. Let's take our live camera and see if we can probe into that inner circle and see something about it. Let me take you closer and maybe we can hear part of the conversation. There's so many people standing here with rapt attention. This may be one of the most significant moments in religious history. "Excuse me, sir, could you step aside and let us through?" And they go wandering through and they take you deeper into that group. Everyone seems to be nodding in agreement, except a few who have furrowed brows of thought. There's an occasional chuckle and even a hum of disagreement. All in all, though, these people are marveling at the one who is speaking. This must be some really great scholar. Here we are, finally in the middle of the press of the crowd. I can't believe my eyes. I'm shocked. It's not an old man. It's not someone who is graying. It is a boy, 12 years old, a 12-year-old boy sitting in the middle, and everyone's listening to him. I don't know that I've ever seen this in a scholarly gathering before. My sources indicate that this young boy is from Nazareth, who traveled to the temple for his special time as a 12-year-old. He's sitting with the scholars and is literally wowing them with his knowledge of the scriptures. They're the ones that should be wowing him. They're the ones who should be teaching him. In our traditions here, he would be listening to them, not them listening to him. That's what makes this moment so unique. Well, there's a couple coming toward him. I'm told that those are his parents. They seem a bit agitated. Maybe they'll let me interview him before they take him away with them. "Excuse me, ma'am, may I please interview your son?" "No, okay, fine. I will get out of your way and let you get to him." They go and they're agitated and they pull him out of the middle of the crowd and they take him to the side and they say, "What in the world are you doing? We've been looking for you everywhere. Do you realize we got a day out of town and we couldn't find you, and here you are sitting right here. What are you doing?" And then he said, "Why do you wonder? I'm about my father's business here." They said, "He may be in heaven, but we're right here, and you're going home with us now." Can you imagine that particular moment? We always make it so glossed over as sort of like, "I must be about my father's business. Come, go home with us." It wasn't that way. Trust me, Mary and Joseph were not happy about what had taken place. They got a day out of town. And when the night came and the families kind of went back in their groups, it was not unusual for the kids to be with relatives and friends and playing around and doing all of this, and they just assumed Jesus was there. But when it's nighttime, you get your kids back with you, and everybody camps together. And when he wasn't there, can you imagine the chill that went over Mary as she began to think, "Where is he? Has something happened?" Can you imagine the feeling that Joseph had? I should have been watching closer. Why didn't we check on this other? The second guessing that would have taken place there. Can you imagine that moment? It'd be the exact same thing that you or I would feel under the same circumstances. Over the last day or so, we had a chance to be with our two sons and our grandchildren and our daughter-in-law. We took them to a Braves game in Atlanta. An 8-year-old, a 6-year-old, and a soon-to-be 4-year-old. And they have more energy than any 12 people you will ever find on this earth. And in the middle of a crowd, you have to watch because one's going in this direction, one's going in this direction, one sees something they want in this direction, and you literally have to be so diligent in keeping up with who is where, and you're reaching for hands, and suddenly you look down and they're not holding your hand, and they're off on a different direction. Who are they with now? Well, they've gone with their dad here, or they've gone with their mom here. And they're used to it more than we are at this point. But I thought about that. I thought about the dynamic of a crowd of people and wanting to keep up with the children there. And some of you are smiling because you deal with that all the time. But it doesn't blunt the fact that in that moment, a 12-year-old boy was missing from his parents, but was back at the temple and was teaching the people who taught people. It was amazing. It was a God moment. Well, seeing is believing, and we've been there for that moment in history. Well, the story goes further. Once they took Jesus with them, and once they went on their way, Jesus was subject to them, is what it says, or he was obedient to them. There was discipline. That's a part of what we find there. I guess it could have all happened this way. And maybe the way I've described it makes it a little bit more human for us. But Luke's gospel is really a simple gospel that it lets us see the real Jesus and the real family in this particular event. Fred Craddock noted, he said, you know, this story unfolds normally, free of miracles, fulfilled prophecies, and special revelations. It's just a family that went to the temple and went back home and had a crisis along the way. And what Mary and Joseph wanted more than anything else was for their son to be safe and sound with them. The revelation that came out of this was something that was happening to Jesus. But what I want you to see is, take that story and put it aside for a second and look at what was taking place and the influences that were there and the little bitty influences that helped shape who Jesus would be as that Savior who walked among us and made such a difference in our lives and ultimately gave Himself for us. We learn something about Mary and Joseph's religious life. Every year they made the 65-mile journey to the temple for a religious experience. Every year. It says it was their custom. They did this. Jesus grew up seeing that that was a priority in life. And at this point, at 12 years of age, he had been all of these different years along, seeing it, being a part of it, watching the religious experience, and knowing that that was a core part of the family life. When you see him teaching the teachers there, you know that he wowed them with his knowledge of Scripture. That knowledge did not come about by happenstance. God didn't just open up his head and pour the knowledge in. He used the same sorts of processes that we use when we teach our children. He went to synagogue school. He heard from his parents. They explained things to him. They answered his questions. He grew in his understanding because the parenting in that home was good. He understood faith because the parenting in that home was a parenting based upon faith. Don't see it as a miracle. See it as good parenting that pleased God. That's how that came about. It matters that our children have strong spiritual examples and foundations in the home. We learned something about the family system. that they did things together. They did things in the larger group. You had lots of relatives and lots of others, and they traveled together on this. And yes, because of the interaction within that, Jesus kind of got lost in the mix there. But what you see is that as a family, they did things together. They made memories together. And this was a memory that would last all these years and still be told to us. We know they were attentive. And you're going to say, yeah, well, why didn't they know he was there? Yeah, they were attentive. It may not have been every minute along the way, but there came a point when they said, where is he? And they went looking for him. Keeping up with our children physically and emotionally and developmentally and spiritually does matter. And that influences who they become later on. They made the journey back to get him. Oh, of course, that's obvious. Of course they would do that. Think of the number of children in our day and time that are abandoned. Not just physically, they're emotionally abandoned. In units that are supposed to be family units. We see it in our home. We saw it in schools where you'd have parents who had no idea what their children were learning, had no idea about the education they were receiving, had no idea of whether they had their homework or even if they carried their lunch that day, had no idea. They were abandoned in that process. One of the things we learn from this is you don't abandon your children emotionally or physically, and you don't abandon them spiritually. How many children are abandoned spiritually by not being encouraged in their faith, by not being taught in their faith? Jesus' family teaches us. You go back and get them. You find out where they are. You bring them to that moment, educationally, emotionally, physically, spiritually. You don't abandon them. They talked with him. Now, sure, Mary and Joseph did the first talking and probably talked pretty sternly to him. You kind of hear it in the tone of that. Where have you been? Why haven't you been here? Where have you? What have you been doing? Didn't you know we were looking for you? We've been worried sick about you. But that's just parental prerogative. We are able to blast off like that to start with. But then they got down to the conversation part where he said, didn't you know I was to be about my Father's business? Somewhere in there began a dialogue that would enhance their relationship and would make a difference. Mary and Joseph's reaction is very telling. They were anxiously searching, which means they were worried and loving and longing to find him. It matters that our children know that they matter and that we genuinely care. They did not understand his response. You're not going to always understand your children. You're just not. And they're not always going to understand us. And there are times you have to just own up to it, admit that. And then you grow out of that experience. Didn't you know I have to be about my Father's business? Well, no, we don't understand that, son. Well, I don't understand that you don't understand, and you don't understand that I don't understand. Maybe we can learn something together. One of my favorite stories with JC is when he turned 16 and he wanted to drive from Thompson, Georgia to Macon. And he was a good kid, safe, didn't do anything that I worried about, but it still was back roads from Thompson, Georgia to Macon, Georgia to go see a friend of his. And he'd only had his license for a few days and, you know, all that stuff. And I thought, I just can't let him do it. And it was also Halloween, and he was going to be little kids on the street. So I said, son, no, I'm not going to let you do that. And he said, Dad, I've never done anything. You can trust me. I'm a good driver. And I said, yes, you're a good driver. You've driven me a lot, and yes, you're a good driver, and yes, I trust you, but I'm not going to let you do it. He said, but Dad, and I said, JC, the problem is you're just not experienced at being a 16-year-old driver. You don't have the experience. And I thought about it, and I said, let me tell you something else. I'm not experienced at being the daddy of a 16-year-old. I said, why don't we do this? You give me a little time to learn, I'll give you a little time to learn, and then you can go drive to Macon. we had to learn together because I didn't understand how to do what I was supposed to be doing. I needed strength from beyond myself. He didn't understand fully the implications of what was there. So sometimes we need to let our kids know that we don't fully understand, but we want to learn and we can learn together. They took him with them, hands on accompanying him. They didn't send him to his room, they brought him with them. They stayed engaged no matter what. And as far as Father's Day is concerned, it's interesting that it was Mary who explained the concern to Jesus. Mary's the one who went and said, "Didn't you know we've been looking for you?" Now, both parents were involved, but Mary's the one who was more vocal there. And then Jesus had to be disciplined. I come back to that because the idea of him being subject means that Jesus was disciplined. It means that discipline was a part of their home. It means that discipline was a part of their love, that discipline was a response of concern. So we always gloss it over and make it like, well, Jesus was perfect and so he was never disciplined or anything like this. Yeah, he was. And part of that is so that we would have the example that even Jesus' parents had to use discipline in his life. Not bad, do you think? Reinforces some of the things that we think about with parenting. But Mary was able to see beyond a single event, and we need to be with our kids. It's not just this event that defines everything. Mary took that, pondered it in her heart. Mary was pretty good at that kind of stuff. She'd hold an idea, and it became a piece of a puzzle. And all along through his life, from birth all the way to the cross, she pondered things. And at the very end, as she stood at the cross, the pieces began to come back together. And it began to explain something to her that was greater than anything she could have seen in just one moment or one event. So as parents, we pay attention to each other. We pay attention to our children. We understand that doing things together is important. We understand that spiritual things are a high priority. You know, if your kids have no reference to spirituality, then they don't have anything to build on there. And the best place to do it is through you and at home. Again, Fred Craddock says, Luke implies in this episode that family love and loyalties have their place and flourish under the higher love and loyalty to God. The higher love and loyalty to God defines everything else. It becomes the high mark for the life. Children are to respect the parents, but parents are also to respect their children. And you stay on top of the small things. And teach your kids this. God functions more in whispers than he does in shouts. And they need to be taught to listen to God's whispers. The little nuanced things, the little things that are taking place within their lives. I know in my life how many times my parents would say, now, God's showing you something there. Pay attention to that. Or God may be leading you in something there. Pay attention to that. That's how I understood call. That's how I understood God's presence in my daily walk. And we constantly remind our children that they matter. Constantly. My favorite story for Father's Day comes from a Harvard preaching professor who tells a story on himself about his five-year-old son. They were at a Christmas play, and prior to that Christmas play, from the fall beginning of school to that point, the little kids had been making things for Christmas. And one of the things this little boy had made was something for his dad, and they had been working with clay and firing it and glazing it, and they did several layers of it and all this stuff. So he'd been working for weeks on this particular project, and he was so excited because at the Christmas play they were able to get their gifts and give them to their parents, and he'd made this special thing for his dad. It was a little pot of some sort, probably an ashtray. That's what we all made when I was coming along. You remember the little ashtrays that even for families that didn't smoke. So, but he made his little clay thing. He had it all wrapped up in a childlike way with newspaper or whatever it was they wrapped it with. They did the play, and at the end of the play, he went over, he grabbed his gift, and he went running to give it to his dad. And as he did, he tripped and he fell, and he lost the package, and it went skidding across the floor. And you could just hear it crunch up as it went along and broke into just a million different pieces. And he burst into tears. There in front of all of his friends, in front of his teachers, burst into tears. And his dad went running over, was afraid he was hurt, and picked him up and said, "Son, are you okay?" "Yes, sir, I'm okay." He said, "Are you hurt?" And he said, "No, I'm not hurt." And he said, the little boy said, "But your gift, it's broken." And the father, trying to console him, said, "Son, it's okay, it doesn't matter, you're okay, it doesn't matter." And the boy cried louder and louder every time his dad said this. And his mom realized what was happening. And she went over and she said, "Son, it does matter. It matters that the gift got broken. That was important. You made it for him. It matters." And then she took him and she said, "Let's pick it up. And we'll go home and we'll make something out of it. We'll fix the gift." And the little boy cleared up. And they went over and they picked up the package and they went home. And the mother took her glue gun and they glued together a mosaic in the shape of a butterfly with all the different colored shards from that little pot. And then he gave it to his dad for Christmas. Out of the brokenness of that, they put something that represented life and hope. But the main thing is that the mother said, "It matters. Let's do something with it. We can't let this moment get away. Even though it's a broken moment, we have to make something out of it." With Jesus, even in that moment when there was a bit of conflict, frankly, he wasn't where he was supposed to be and his parents got worried, they made something out of it, something wonderful out of it. They learned something about God's work in Jesus' life. Jesus learned something about their love in that moment. Together, they went forward, and you can find elements of that moment all through his ministry. I really think that's the moment when Jesus realized his ministry wasn't just about sitting and talking to the scholars. It was going beyond that and being a part of something greater. He was. And for the rest of his ministry, he walked among crowds and he touched lives. How was God working in that? How is God working in our lives each time? Oh, it matters what they know. It matters those little things. We never need to tell them by word, deed, or example that things don't matter. They will not know unless we go and find them, unless we show them, unless we live the faith with them. That's what God called us to. That's what He teaches us. And we learn it by a glimpse into His own family here on earth. Amen. Will you bow with me? Spirit of God, thank you for your gift of love and your presence. Thank you for what you've taught us. Things do matter. They matter so much. Even the little things. And the way that we plant those seeds make a difference in how our children grow up and what they become, and our grandchildren, and those we just influence with our lives. Please be with us and teach us how to do what you would have us to do. Make us conduits of your grace and the things that need to be learned in the lives of those we influence. And teach us too, as we are in that process. In the name of Jesus, amen. Our hymn of invitation is hymn 570, "'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus." As we sing that together, if God has spoken to you in any way, if there is a decision to be made, I will meet you at the front as we stand together and as we sing. thank you for being a part of worship this morning. I notice around the room that we have a lot of family members who've come to be with their dads on this particular day, and I think that's a wonderful gift. And a lot of you have memories on this particular day, and they become a little more sensitive and even more special on a day like this. I pray God's blessings upon you. I pray God's blessings as you celebrate together and as you enjoy seeing something wonderful that family has brought about in your relationships. And it's my prayer that God will continue to be with you in that. Now I'm going to make an announcement. The reason that door is out on that side is it is being redone just like this door was redone, and they couldn't get them back for Sunday. So when people are going out there saying, did somebody break into the door? Did we, you know, whatever happened? What happened is it's being refinished and it will be back and you'll thoroughly enjoy it. We found out they're made out of cypress and they are very old doors and they've been redone beautifully. But they have to be taken off site for that. So that's why it's boarded up on that side. So if you had a question, that gives you the answer. Now, that's from the public service announcement. Now, as you prepare to go from this place, it is my prayer that you will never take for granted the role of influence you have in the lives of others. Whether it's being a father or a mother or someone who influences someone else like a father or a mother, no matter what is the influence, understand that God is using that to shape some life somewhere. So do it diligently. Be open to how the Spirit leads you. And may God bless and multiply your influence for the good, not only in individual lives, but in the world that they impact. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
May the Lord